Hi, I'm Nic Gorman. I am the writer and the director of Human Traces. Okay, so the film's set on a sub-Antarctic island, which is a little body of islands that basically lie in between New Zealand and Antarctica at the bottom of the world. There's a husband and wife scientist team. Their job there is to get rid of all the pests on the island. And a stranger arrives, someone they haven't known before, and that's kind of where the story begins. I think as a storyteller, the setting, the island, was the first thing that I came to, before the characters, before the structure, before the plot. And I was just fascinated by these places, these islands which I sort of researched and I read a lot about, these, because of their kind of unique character. They're amazing kind of individual ecosystems, but they're also places that have actively kind of resisted any kind of sense of humans trying to control them or settle them or kind of do stuff. They had whalers there for a bit, and the settlement was started, but it failed because just the weather was too inhospitable. There's been all these shipwrecks here, all these shipwrecks there. So I thought it was kind of an interesting place to set characters and put characters on. And everything else in the film grew out of the location, the character archetypes, the structure, the plot, all kind of came from this place, which, you know, it's almost a cliche to say, but the island is its own character. The location is as important in the film as any of the characters, because the characters in this film are defined by their relationship to the land, the place they're on. So in terms of the production, we'd looked a long time to find the right place. The challenge was finding somewhere that did feel isolated, that did feel like the end of the world. So we'd find these amazing, beautiful beaches, but there was too many kind of introduced trees, or there was like a farm in the background, or there was, you know, some power lines that you could see, and we weren't going to be able to get the coverage for it. So we sort of walked, and we sort of basically ended up filming at the southernmost point of New Zealand, apart from all the islands that sort of lie at the bottom, but it was pretty much as far south as you can go in New Zealand, and by extension as far south you can go in the world. So, you know, we had to kind of drive like half an hour from the closest town over a dirt road, and then we had to leave our cars, and we had to get four-wheel drives to run us up and down from the place. So it was incredibly challenging, but it was also... what made the shoot incredibly special was we were so bonded to this place, because it was so hard to get to, so inhospitable, but it did really kind of make us, it informed us as kind of creatives, as crew, in the same way that the landscape informs the characters in the film. Decision to kind of come up with this sort of the triptych structure, I think came, like I was saying before, like it came out of this notion of place. So these characters are geographically isolated, and that isolation makes them kind of psychologically isolated from everybody else as well. And I kind of started thinking about perspective and isolation, and how kind of being in a place like that does strange things to you. And it kind of, that felt quite organic, that progression into the actual structure, where we just spend time with each of these characters, and we really wanted to dig into their heads. So the way it was written, the way it was shot, it's very kind of a close subjective experience, in that you're kind of in walking in these characters' shoes. So to then kind of tell the story using the three of them, it was a kind of a really useful way into the story for me. Yeah, you're so right. Especially with low budget stuff, you kind of need to be able to kind of work together and have kind of like-minded souls. And the three performers, the three lead actors, kind of embrace the ethos behind the film, and that they kind of, you know, it was a low budget film. We knew we were going right down south. We knew the weather was going to be hard, but in a way, kind of, I think it was really kind of inspirational for the crew to see the way that the actors just embraced the conditions, and like, you know, they were always the ones who are saying, let's do another take, let's kind of get the shot done, I don't mind getting in the water, I don't mind standing there, like, you know, there was a real kind of braveness and energy to their performances, which I think kind of inspired us all. And I think, you know, it's one of the most wonderful things as a writer, is being able to give your characters away because you spend so much time with them when they're on the page, when you look on the computer screen. And these people come in, and like I remember sort of when like Vinnie came in for his audition for the character of Ricky, like he informed me what I had been trying to write but hadn't quite got there. And like when Vinnie came in, you know, he made the character more alive than I could possibly have imagined. So it's kind of, yeah, it's one of those wonderful pleasures. Well, it wasn't shot we tried to do it as linear as we could, but, you know, just in terms of kind of locations, we needed to, you know, not do it. And we kind of had a thing that when we were shooting, it was either this is Glenn's shot or this is Sarah's shot or this is Ricky's shot. And in the edit, it didn't necessarily translate in that way. We kind of pulled scenes from other people's story to put them in. But actually in the shoot itself, it was a really kind of useful... a useful way of kind of recalibrating ourselves. You know, if we said we'd shoot a scene from Glenn's perspective and we kind of said, okay, that's it. And now we're going to do it from Sarah's perspective as well. So we kind of, while we weren't actively kind of re-blocking or changing too much, it was just kind of like just a mental shift that we all kind of took as a crew to like kind of think about whose story it was, where we needed to be at that time. It's one of the hardest things to kind of work out, I think, the notion of ambiguity. And it's such a balance, you know, and I think kind of, you know, the great films use it so well because if you, as an audience member, the worst thing to do or to have done to you is to be kind of talked at, or if the director's didactic or something, I think it can be a real sort of turn-off. But, you know, on the other side, if people aren't clear, that then they find it frustrating. And I think we did test screenings, and we're always kind of like kind of aware of that line that we kind of needed to walk down. And it was just kind of, you know, I'd send the links out to friends, and we'd have little kind of mini test screens, we'd have bigger test screenings, and it was just kind of making sure that at any point we weren't alienating the audience, but still kind of retaining that sense of mystery. You just want them to feel something, like either moved or scared or angry. I think kind of getting a reaction out of an audience. I think the kind of the screenings in Tiff have been so good because we've had great Q&As, and I think it's a really good indicator of how people are engaging with the film. And then when we leave the cinema, the conversation kind of continues and we're sort of talking to people out in the foyer and stuff. And I think, you know, having that sort of level of audience engagement is exactly what you want as a filmmaker.